quando vide la luna uscire da una nuvola, mi sembrò più dolce anche l'amore. Guardo negli occhi la ragazza, negli occhi verdi come il mare. Poi all'improvviso uscì una lacrima e mi credette affogare. Te voglio bene assai, ma tanto, tanto bene sai, e non cotena ormai, che scioglia sangue. Della lirica, dove ogni dramma è un falso, e con un po' di trucco e con la mimica puoi diventare un altro. Ma due occhi che ti guardano così vicini e veri, ti fa scordare le parole. Così diventò tutto piccolo, anche le notti là in America. Ti volti e vedi la tua vita come la bianca scia d'un'eca. Ma sì, è la vita che finisce, ma lui non ci pensò poi tanto. Anzi, si sentiva già felice e incominciò il suo canto. Te voglio bene assai, ma tanto, tanto bene sai, e non ormai, che scioglio sangue.
Se una cosa semplice io te la direi, ma c'è una confusione dentro e qui attorno a me. Tu preferisci evitare e forse la colpa non è tua. Potrei tentare un'altra volta, ma non sono io che devi sentire. Piedi nudi camminiamo
ombra c'è una ragazza dopo che aveva pianto lei. Poi si schiarisce la voce e incomincia il canto. Te voglio bene assai, ma tanto, tanto bene sai, è nato te ormai, che scioglie sangue. In mezzo al mare, penso alle notti là in America, guardano solo le lampade, la bianca scia d'America. Senti il dolore nella musica, senza dal pianoforte, ma quando vide la luna uscire dalla luna, più dolce anche la morte. Guardo negli occhi la ragazza, quegli occhi verdi come il mare. Poi all'improvviso uscì una lacrima e mi credette affogare. Della lira, dove ogni dramma è un falso, con un po' di trucco e con la mimica puoi diventare un altro. Ma due occhi che ti guardano così vicini e belli, ti fa scordare le parole, confondono pensieri. Così diventò tutto piccolo, anche le notti là in America. Ti volti e vedi la tua vita, come la bianca scia d'America. Ma sì, è la vita che finisce, ma lui non ci pensò poi tanto. Anzi, si sentiva già felice e incominciò il suo canto. Te voglio bene assai, ma tanto, tanto bene sai, è nato te ormai, che scioglie sangue. Yeah. c'è una confusione dentro e qui attorno a me. Tu preferisci evitare e forse la colpa non è tua. Potrei tentare un'altra volta, ma non sono io. Forte il vento, c'è una vecchia terrazza vicino al golfo di Sorrento. Un uomo abbraccia una ragazza dopo che aveva pianto, poi si schiarisce la voce e incomincia il canto. Penso alle notti là danza dal pianoforte. Ma quando vide la luna uscire dal nuvolo, mi sembrò più dolce anche la mia. Thank you.
On behalf of the Mancini family, I want to thank everyone for being here today to celebrate the life of Renato Mancini. I'm going to open us up with a verse. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used for his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him in the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Even as Grant has just read those words from Philippians 2, one of the things that we heard as Andy and I were talking with the family this week about Renato is his heart for service. That man loved to serve, and he loved to give. And in so many ways, that modeled Jesus, in that Jesus, as Grant just read, came down to serve us by becoming man, then giving his life for us so that every knee will bow one day and every tongue confess. And that's what Renato wanted. He wanted Jesus to be glorified as a result of his service, his life before him. So if you'll pray with me, and then we'll sing joyfully of Renato's relationship with Jesus. Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, we do thank you now that we can come and celebrate this life of this man that we knew and loved so well, and who loved us. And we just thank you, Lord, that love ultimately originated with you and has come down to this earth through Jesus and then through the Spirit that we can enjoy and know and celebrate in this life, even today. Lord, we know that you have had a perfect timing to take Renato to be with you in heaven forever and ever. And even though that leaves us with a great sense of loss in a sense, Lord, we also do rejoice today knowing that he is with you and that he has been made perfect, even more so than he was in this life, as talented, as gifted as this man was. And we again just thank you. Thank you that we can come and celebrate. We just ask for your Holy Spirit's help as we worship now, Lord. And Lord, help us to have great memories of Renato and the way that you have used him in our lives to bless us and help us. And we pray these things in Jesus' name now. Amen. We're going to sing a real oldie goldie of a hymn for the opening hymn, He Lives, He Lives. Do you remember that old hymn from years ago? Don't sing that too much anymore, but this really does reflect, again, the relationship that Renato felt that he had with Jesus. So sing with great gladness and gusto of God's, of Jesus' life within us.
And though my heart grows weary, I never will that he is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way.
Good morning. My name is Carly Mancini, and I had the pleasure of being Renato's only granddaughter, who we knew as our Nono. So we are going to read in Galatians, fruits of spirit in the way that the Lord has called us to live. Galatians 5, 22, 25, and it says, but the fruit of the spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus has crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other.
Again, as we think about that passage, we all hopefully want more of the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, to be evident in our lives, to be more like Jesus in that way. And again, that was Renato's prayer, that he might be more full of the fruit of the Spirit. But you know, Renato, like all of us, was not perfect. Even though he had a sense of love and joy and peace and all those kinds of things, he didn't have it to the degree that Jesus has, that Jesus is calling us to. With all the blessings, all the talents Renato had, yet he struggled. He struggled with sin, just like all of us struggle with sin. You know, that's part of God's plan for us in this life, to struggle with sin, to help us to realize that we need him, that we can't do this life on our own, that we need his Spirit, his working, his forgiveness, all those kinds of things that sin actually brings into our lives. And so God uses our sin to make him, that is God, all the more special to us, because we can know a sense of forgiveness. We can know a strength and a help and a growth in our life before Jesus. And that, again, is what Renato's desire was. He wasn't perfect. He didn't do everything just like he should have. We all made mistakes. He made mistakes. But his desire was to know Jesus more intimately so that he might know more of the fruit of the Spirit and might continue in growth, in looking more like Jesus. I think I'm going to let you be seated on this next hymn. It's kind of a contemplative hymn. And again, it's a very old hymn. I remember singing this when I was like 15 years old. So 50 years ago, it's, again, an old one, but one of the first kind of young people's songs that I can ever remember. When I was first, a believer growing up in the church, all we had was hymns. We didn't have anything besides hymns. This was one of the first songs I remember that came along that young people used to sing because it was not a hymn and something that kind of expressed, again, relationship with Jesus. So let's sing He's Everything to Me. I think many of you will recognize it. In the stars His handiwork I see. On the wind He speaks with majesty. Though He ruleth over land and sea, what is that to me? I will celebrate nativity, for it has a place in history. Sure He came, He set His people free. What is that to me? Till by faith I met Him face to face, and I felt the wonder of His grace, and I knew that He was more than just a God who didn't care, that lived away out there, and now He walks beside me day by day, ever watching o'er me lest I stray, helping me to find that narrow way. He's everything till by faith I met Him face to face, and I felt the wonder of His grace, and I knew that He was more than just a God who didn't care, that lived away out there, and now I walk beside Him day by day, ever watching o'er me lest I stray, me to find that narrow way. He said everything to me.
Wow. Now for the emotional side of the family. I look around this room, and boy, do I know how proud Dad would be. Thank you for being here. On behalf of my mother, Faye, my sister, Angela, my dad's brothers in Italy, Silvio and Giorgio, we just want to thank you for what you've all meant to us through the years, how you've watched over us and helped us over the last few days. Hadn't been easy, but we're getting there. God bless my dad with so many gifts and talents. You know, being his only son, I got to see those and I got compared to him with a lot of those talents, and that was never easy. But the things I learned from my father are truly amazing. Paul wrote in the book of Ephesians, "We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works." Now, my father would correct this particular passage, and he would say, we are God's masterpiece. We are God's craftsmanship. We are God's prize. That's what my dad would say about that. I believe that God gave my dad some amazing talents, and I know many of you witnessed those as well. He had a purpose to serve his fellow brother, and he knew it, and he did it well. He did it so well. I can't tell you. It's an inspiration to me. The Bible also says, whoever does not have the Spirit cannot receive these gifts that come from God's Spirit. You cannot earn or deserve these gifts. That is why they are called gifts. And they are an expression of God's grace to us. So as you remember my dad, think like I do. The grace that God bestowed on my father was incredible. Incredible. And I think you would agree with me. You know, Dad used these gifts to help his fellow brothers, and I got a few that I want to just call out real quick. So bear with me on these. These are just some of the things that I witnessed over the years, some of the stories that you have told me, and some of the examples that I experienced with my dad. Fabricating a wrought iron gate for a friend's courtyard, preparing mowers and weed eaters for the friends in the neighborhood, designing a logo for a friend's business, rebuilding the engine of a friend's Fiat because he ran it without oil. Love that one. Creating a rendering of a new automotive dealership for a friend. Teaching a friend to paint portraits using watercolor instead of oil. And then challenging him in a competition. How great. Preparing and curing prosciutto from a friend's pig farm. And it was great. It really was. I didn't want to eat it at first, but I did. Helping a friend's daughter with a school project on how an Italian transitioned as an immigrant. Building toys for a friend's kids like tanks and airplanes. Incredible. Shopping at the flea market with a friend to buy treasures for their next project. Where are you, Hawkins? There you are. Thank you. Building a patio using brick pavers for a friend. Painting a portrait of a friend's lake house. Creating a wrought iron and stained glass door for a friend's house. Fabricating a hoist for a friend's truck who hunted and wanted to pull the animals out of the field. Building steps and a handrail for a friend's house. Restoring a friend's Vespa. Telling the NASA Day stories to friends who had interest in space and wanted to know his story. Cooking pasta and biscotti for his friends. He had his own recipes and he was always tinkering with them, always throwing something extra in there, taking something out. So fun. Helping friends plan their dream vacations to Italy. The list goes on. I could stand up here probably for, pull Lou Party up here for another 30 minutes and tell stories, but these are just some of the few. And these are memories that'll stay with me. What Dad enjoyed doing most, though, was sharing his paintings with friends. You know, I didn't even mention really much about his paintings, and that's where he expressed, I think, what was inside of him and the grace that God gave him. I sit back and I look at these paintings today, and I'm just thinking to myself, what was going through his mind when he did that? How did he do that? So that's probably, you have your own story. You probably have have a painting of his. If you don't, one of the things that we've decided to do as a family, there are several prints of original paintings that he did of Greenville landscapes. And those will be placed out in the foyer after the service is over. And I want each of you, please, to take one or take two of a painting that you like and remember my dad with it. Thank you.
I will get to this passage of Matthew chapter 25, but I want to start with a different passage. When I look to the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you set into place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you would care for him. You've made him a little bit lower than the heavenly beings. You've crowned him with glory and honor. You've given him dominion over all of the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet. Psalm 8. Seems like a fitting place to start for the artist of space. When I consider the heavens, when I consider all of these things, the work of your hands, Renato believed in the gift of creation. He was amazed at the vastness of it, of this world that has been given to us to enjoy. And everybody in this room, you're not a mistake. We're all created by a God who knows us and loves us and has given us this world to enjoy and to see the vastness of it and the beauty of it. One of the unique things about Renato is his ability to combine together what we believe is inherently unique to Christianity, which is transcendence and immanence. The big transcendence of who God is and the vastness of the universe and the stars, and then also immanence, that we have a God who has come to us. My last physical correspondence, by that I mean through the mail, with Renato was December this past year. And he sent me a package, as he would often do, send me packages of little things that he wanted me to know, stories and poems and paintings. And the last one was three paintings that he had done, with another painting of the rocket ships and how they went into space, with a portrait of the moon and a poem about sheep, all of this transcendence of all the world out there. And then the very last page was a recipe for a very simple pesto pasta. All the transcendence, and then cook this very simple meal. Elizabeth and I were 22 when we first went over to your house for a simple pasta with just the best ingredients. He loved to paint. We've used, ever since Steve and Kathy introduced Renato's artwork into our services, who I know he loved you and you loved him very much. Ever since that time, his artwork has always been involved in our services, whether Christmas or Easter, because it shows the transcendence of who God is. He saw beauty and color in ways most of us could only dream of. And in a world where we constantly look at screens, today is a reminder that we should lift up our heads and look to the stars, because our days pass like a sigh. They're quick. Death reminds us of that. It reminds us that our days are numbered, and we come and we go, and we're here for a few short years to share our gifts with each other. But the Lord is eternal. Job 38, then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this that darkens my counsel by words without knowledge? Dress yourself for action like a man, and I will question you, and I will make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding, who determines the measurements? Surely you knew. Who outstretched the line upon it? Or where were its bases sunk? Or who laid the cornerstone when the morning stars sang together?" Creation is a gift. But creation is also fallen. Renato was fallen. We're fallen. He loved this world that he lived in, which is amazing because he also saw the horrors of it. Saw his uncle being shot when he was trying to warn his family. Saw men executed indiscriminately, was forced to take his two younger siblings under his care and flee into the mountains. He saw all of that. He saw the worst of the worst and still believed in the goodness of God. There's a gift of creation. And the second thing I want to talk is about the gift of Renato. I am not a prophet. But I want to say prophetically, there's not one person in this room that is as gifted as that person. I think we could all agree. And I think if we added like 10 of us together, we're probably not all as gifted as Renato. His ability, when we went to his house the first time, he showed us in his basement that Leaning Tower of Pisa built to scale. I can't even draw that to scale. And he built one to scale. And one of the things that he gives us, one of the gifts that Renato gives us, is perspective. I'll never forget it. Right in that foyer, I can't remember the bride. All I remember, it was pouring down rain. And it was T minus like 5 minutes before she was supposed to walk down this aisle. And it was me and the bride and the maid of honor, and we were trying to figure out how to get her out of this building and into those back doors while it's pouring down rain. And Renato comes in late. And he comes right in these doors, which he was not supposed to do. He came right in these doors, saw the bride who is weeping because it's raining on her wedding day, grabbed her by the head and said, "The Lord is blessing you. It's raining. This is a sign of good fortune." And that perspective, she had no idea that Italians thought that rain was a sign of good fortune. And isn't it beautiful that, Lord willing, it's going to pour this afternoon. Hopefully at the graveside, it will just pour as a sign of God's blessing on this day. He gives us perspective. He was a great gift. Angela, Tony, Faye, you were gifts to him too. You loved him so well, Faye. You gave him so much grace and encouragement. You were such a constant presence in his life. And we thank you for the way that you loved him and the way that you fell in love with that beautiful, young, handsome man that we saw there in the pictures. And then there's Grant, who somehow married Angela after you threw her off the Vespa in the first 5 minutes of meeting Renato. Threw her right off the back while Renato was fixing the sunlight on the roof, promptly gets on the Vespa with Angela, puts it vertical, throws her off the back, then puts it in the ditch, and somehow he still said yes. And Grant, he loved you too, and I know you loved him as well. He was a gift to me as well. Years ago, it's at home, he drew a picture of an apple and then wrote a poem for me. And he said, "You're the apple of God's eye. Don't ever forget it." Who does that? It was a gift just to remind me how God looks at me. Now to Matthew chapter 25, when the Son of Man comes in glory and all the angels with him, then he'll sit on his glorious throne, and before him will be gathered all the nations, and he'll separate out people one from another as a shepherd separates out the sheep from the goats. And he'll place the sheep on his right, but the goats on his left, and the king will say to those on the right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you welcomed me. I was naked, you clothed me. I was sick, you invited me in. I was in prison, and you came to me." Then the righteous will answer him, saying, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty or give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick and in prison and visit you?" And the king, the transcendent one, the king said, "Truly I say to you, as you did to one of the least of my brothers, you did it to me." And that's the verse that the family wanted us to remind you of. That gift to do to others as we would want done to us. Renato understood the free gift that comes with Christ, that it's not earned. As talented as he was, as gifted as he was, you can't earn nor can you paint your way into heaven. You need the free gift of Christ. One of the most disappointing ends to a movie that I can think of is Saving Private Ryan. I loved the movie up until the last 5 minutes, when at the graves of the people that have gone before him, that young soldier asked the question, "Have I earned this? Have I earned it?" And the gospel answer is, you can't. Jesus has earned it for us. That's our confidence. Our confidence this morning is not that Renato was able to hold on to Christ, if it's Christ's everlasting arms have held on to Renato. And I'm so thankful, as I told the family in the room right before we came out, I am so thankful that this has happened on Holy Week. Because we will always remember, when we think of Renato, that Jesus has conquered death, hell, and the grave forever. Our hope is that we will soon see Renato in the new heavens, in the new earth, because of the third point, the gift of Christ. 3 weeks ago was the second to last time that I saw Renato besides the ICU, but I saw him a number of weeks ago. I had just preached, and I had gotten word that he was back in the hospital, and after preaching three times, all I want to do is go find a meal and go to bed. But I felt the Holy Spirit saying, don't do any of that, go to the hospital. And I won't go into all the background of what was happening on that day, but I went right to the hospital after preaching the last sermon, and Faye was there, and she said, he's all yours. So I went over to him, and he grabbed my hand, and he rubbed it all over his face. And then I bent down, and I kissed his forehead. I don't know why. I don't do that to men. But it seemed like the right thing to do at the time. And I yelled in his ear, and he kept repeating over and over and over and over again, the Lord is so wise. The Lord is so wise. I think it was his way, without going into the details, to communicate, God is so gracious to me. Those are the last physical words I heard from him. We weren't able to talk when he was in the ICU. But the last physical words that I heard from him anyway was, the Lord is wise. Our Lord knows what he's doing. And he's filled with wisdom and he's filled with graciousness. I too was going to read Ephesians chapter 2. For we are his workmanship, created in Jesus Christ for good works, his masterpiece, which God has prepared before that we should walk in them. And when we talk about these gifts, we're not only gifted by God, but we get to share the gifts of the irrevocable gift of Christ's love for us. If you're not a Christian, I just want to close with this one story and then one quote, but I want you to think about where your hope is on a day like today. Last story, I might tell this Sunday. I tell it about every other Easter. Years ago, I was preaching in the morning, and I was going to preach in the evening, and I had appointments all throughout the day that Sunday afternoon. And so I told the congregation that morning, I thought very sternly, Italy is playing France in the World Cup. I'm going to TiVo it. Back in the day, we had TiVo. I'm going to TiVo it. I will not get home until 7:30 tonight. None of you tell me who won the game. I told them in every service, sternly, do not tell me who won this game. I want to go home. I want to enjoy it myself. I got through the afternoon meetings, got through lunch. I was getting ready to preach the evening service. I walked into those doors right there. And Renato is right there at the soundboard, just staring at me. And then he starts to unbutton his shirt, slowly. Which, again, we don't do that at Mitchell Road. We're very buttoned up kind of people. And he starts to unbutton it, and he's just staring at me. And then he opens it up, and it's an Italian jersey underneath his dress shirt. And I knew right then, I was so mad and so exasperated by the whole thing, but so entertained. I didn't know what to do. I just laughed because I knew right then, Italy won. There's no way that he would wear that shirt if France won. And I went home after I chastised them, and I watched the game anyway. And that's the gospel. At the crucifixion and at the resurrection, Jesus is one. He revealed himself in the transfiguration. Just like the Allied forces won on D-Day, they still had to live out until V-Day, Victory Day, but Christ at the cross and Christ at the resurrection has already won our salvation. Now we have to live it out. We still have to play the game until the new heavens and the new earth. But we can know that Christ has already won for Renato, and he's already won for us. And that's what gives us the confidence and the encourage and the faith to wake up tomorrow and to share our gifts with each other. Joseph Bailey, I've read this at a couple funerals lately. God, I just can't get it out of my head. Joseph Bailey lost three of his children just Sit in that for a second. Lost three kids, and he wrote a book called A View from the Hearse as he tried to deal with losing his kids. And this is what he says about the new heavens and the new earth. He said, I can't prove the existence of heaven. I accept it by faith on the authority of Jesus Christ, who said, in my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. But for that matter, if I were a twin in the womb, I doubt that I could prove the existence of earth to my mate, to the other twin in the room. He would probably object to the idea that earth beyond the womb was ridiculous, that the womb was the only earth we would ever know. If I tried to explain to earthlings that earthlings live in a greatly expanded environment and they breathe air, he would only be more skeptical. After all, a fetus lives in water and fluid. Who could imagine being able to live in a universe of air? To him, such a transition would seem impossible. It would take a birth to prove the existence of earth to a fetus. A little pain, a dark tunnel, and then a gasp of air, and then the whole wide world. Green grass, laps in the lake, the ocean, horses. How could a fetus imagine a horse? And with enough room that you don't have to shove, and the universe beyond, there is truly more to this life. Leave the black and white, and to the polychrome color, believe in the textured, pungent, sensual existence of an unfolding heaven where each chapter is as wonderful as the first. I don't know, this is conjective theology, but I would like to think that after Renato passed through the shadow of death, because he's still with the Lord, absent from the body, present with the Lord, I would like to think that the first thing that he said is, wow, look at the colors. I've never seen anything like this, this expanded world. And then he probably said, Peter, come here, I make you a simple pasta. And Jesus says, no, this is my feast. You're my guest. You come, let me serve you. What kind of a God do we have that welcomes us to the feast of heaven? In the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit. Father, we pray, thanking you for the life of Renato, but more than that, all of this day would be despair and pain and tearing our clothes were it not for the grace and the victory of Christ. We thank you for his life. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for this world. Father, and I pray that we would celebrate today. We would grieve with hope, but we would be reminded that every second we have is a gift from you. Now may we go into this world and may we live believing you, our transcendent God, has come to us in your imminence so that we could know you, so that we could celebrate, Christ, your victory, so that we could sing of your amazing grace. And we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
I did have the opportunity to visit Renato in the hospital on the day that he died. And I went right after lunch, and he was still cognizant and was able to carry on a conversation with me. And the very first thing that he said to me when I came into the room was, thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate it so much. And a few minutes later, we were at St. Francis, so the hospital chaplain came in, and that was the same greeting that Renato gave to him. Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate this so much. And you could just tell that it was a very, very genuine appreciation that Renato had. When we think of this next hymn, The Amazing Grace, I really believe that that was exemplifying so clearly to me the grace of God in Renato's life, that he appreciated what other people did for him. He appreciated the little things that people did. Just that spirit of appreciation is part of God's grace given to us. And now we have the opportunity to express that grace back to Jesus, to say thank you. Thank you for what you've done for me, Jesus. So much more than we could do for anybody else. Let's stand and sing about that now, the amazing grace that is ours in Christ Jesus. Benediction is a word of blessing. So hear this word of blessing to you from our God. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Have that hope as you leave this place in God's great salvation for us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Go in peace, and don't forget Tony's offer to you of these prints that are out there. Please take them. They're there for you for the taking. Please do that on the way out.